Let's pray. Father, thank you for the reality that we do have a hope, a living hope. Not a wishful thinking, but a certainty that when we put our trust in you, whatever happens in this life, you can redeem and you will bring it all together in the end, some way, somehow. We don't fully understand that, but we know and put our hope in that reality. And so for Debbie and Casey and the kids right now as they grieve, as they weep, God, just be near to them. Remind them that you weep with them. And comfort them, God, in a way that only you can. And God, may we be the friends and the church and the body with them and for them during this time of grief as well. So God, just bless your word now. God, open up our hearts and our minds. Help us to be attentive. Help us to hear, God, what it is that you're saying to us. In Jesus' name, amen. So we are wrapping up a three-part series where we are looking at the mission that Jesus was given on earth. If you have a Bible, go ahead and open up to Luke chapter 4. And I want to remind you that as a church, we are constantly needing to remind ourselves of why we exist and what our purpose is. And my question I want to ask right now is, do you know your purpose? Do you have purpose? See, here's the thing about purpose when it comes to a follower of Christ. You don't have to find what your purpose is. You already have it. Your purpose is something that God has given you. It's something that you've been anointed with. And when you're anointed, and don't forget, in Luke chapter 4, it says that Jesus was anointed. That's what he opens up the book of Isaiah, and he says he's been anointed. And anointing means that you've been given a calling, a purpose. It means that you have power beyond your own abilities to do the things that God has called you to do. And anointing also is a type of protection. We are not necessarily protected from the consequences of sin in this world as Debbie and Casey are experiencing now. But there is a level of protection that we are protected from. There is something that we have in Christ that nobody can take away. It is what is most important. God has our hearts, our souls. We are secure. We've been sealed by the promises of God that whatever happens in this life, we will be with him for all eternity. That is what we put our hope in. But here's the thing about purpose. Your past cannot take away what your purpose is. Your failures cannot take away what your purpose is. What you did when you were 25 years old cannot take away the purposes that God has planned out for you and given you from the foundation of the earth. When you were in your mother's womb, being knit together, he had purposes and plans for your life. And those cannot be taken away from you. I want to remind you that as we read through the scriptures about the great women and men of faith, men like Noah, who was a drunk, Jacob, who was a liar, Moses, who was a murderer, David was an adulterer, Rahab was a whore, the widow in Sidon that Jesus brings up in Luke chapter 4 was a foreigner, poor, a widow. There was no one more vulnerable in that culture than a widow. Naaman, who was an enemy of God's people. Peter denied that he knew Jesus. When I was a kid, I flunked Bible twice, and here I am teaching Bible to middle schoolers. I never read a book, wrote a paper, or gave a speech in high school, and I've been let go from churches twice. Nothing that has happened to you, nothing that you've done, any mistake you've done, or anything that anyone else has done to you can take away your purpose. I want to remind you of a very, very popular verse, Romans 8:28, and we know, that is certainty, that in all things, good and bad, that God works for the good of those who love him and have been called according to what? His purposes. In men's Bible study, we had it out here and under the gazebos on Tuesday night. It was a great Bible study. We had about 12 people. And we talked about, in Genesis, the story of Isaac and Jacob. And what a mess. When you read through the book of Genesis, you realize, man, these people have made a mess of their lives and their parenting is horrible, polygamy, all kinds of wacky stuff going on in the book of Genesis. And yet, in spite of that, God still accomplished his purposes through very flawed people like Abraham. Abraham, like Isaac, like Jacob. And so it's a reminder for us that your worst mistakes may actually be the seeds that God wants to use to grow greatness and do great things in your life and through your life. Ephesians 2:10, I think I quoted this verse last week. It says that we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works which he has prepared in advance for us to do. So you have purpose. If you don't know what your purpose is, come talk to me, talk to someone you trust, but you need to know that you have a purpose. You haven't lost it. It hasn't been taken away from you. You may just not know exactly what it is. But it does have something to do with our purpose as a church, which is making disciples who are enjoying life with Jesus. Now, I say enjoying life, I got to be careful here. And I've probably said this before, but in the Western world, especially in America, where it is all about feeling good, where it's all about whatever makes you happy must be okay. We got to be careful here. This enjoying life is it is a fruit of your relationship with Jesus, your relationship with other people, and what you are doing to serve and bless the world that we live in. As you guys know, I pray for the persecuted church, and this past week I prayed for a woman named Xia, I think that's how you pronounce her name, she's from China, and she was a house church leader, and somehow the government found out that she was secretly meeting with other Christians in her home, and so they arrested her, put her in prison. They ended up putting her in charge of the other prisoners, which meant she had to stay awake for much of the night, and she decided to make good use of that time during the night when all the other prisoners were getting rest and sleeping, and so she began praying for them. Every night she began praying for them, and she was surprised. It caught her off guard. She wasn't aware that this would happen, but the joy that came from that time in the middle of the night as she prayed for other people really, really surprised her. In fact, she got let out of prison after a couple of weeks, and she continued that practice, that habit of waking up in the middle of the night and praying for people. So joy is something that is a byproduct, is something that comes from your intimate relationship with God. And so we say here at Boulder Creek, we are making disciples who enjoy life with Jesus. God does not want us to be robots that diligently obey him. He could have made us that way, but if he had made us that way, there would be no relationship, there would be no love. And God is love, and that's what he wants from us. He wants our affection, he wants our love, he wants our hearts. You look at the life of Jesus and had this beautiful relationship that he had with the Father. In fact, he was often going off by himself to pray, to be alone with the Father. But Jesus also made it his practice to be with others. Now think about this, because God is God and Jesus is God. And he could have accomplished salvation. He could have accomplished everything that he wants to accomplish in this universe without us. It's kind of like some of you when you maybe had a two-year-old who wanted to help, right? And it's not very helpful, but they get a lot of joy out of it. For some reason, and I don't fully understand why, but Jesus wants to do life with other people. He wants to accomplish his plans with and through other people. He rarely, other than when he went alone to pray, did anything alone. He brought people together, by the way, who would have nothing to do with one another apart from Jesus said, come follow me, come follow me. You're way over here politically, come follow me. You're way over here politically, come follow me. In fact, he had two people in his 12 that he had chosen. One was compromised and served the Roman government, and one was part of an organization trying to take down and overthrow the Roman government. How do you think they got along the first few months together? And plus, there were dozens of others that included women who provided for them financially. And so, enjoying life with Jesus, with others, and for others. And this is so essential. We cannot miss this. This is like a three-legged stool. Without this leg, it collapses. It doesn't stand up. The church is the only organization on the planet Earth that exists not only for the sake of its members, but also for the sake of its non-members. But like gravity that pulls us down, organizations all suffer from bureaucracy syndrome. And what I mean by that is that organizations, and I talked about this last week, we tend to turn inward and we want to protect what we have. And we lose our mission. We forget our purpose and why we were put here. And it happens all the time to secular organizations as well as to Christian ones. It's when we lose our mission, we forget our purpose, and the focus becomes about protection. Protection. And we begin to measure success differently when we fall into that place. For a lot of time, for a lot of people, a lot of organizations, even Christian ones, there becomes this new bottom line. And that bottom line is, how's the budget? How's our finances? And here's the danger for us in the Western world, because you can be a part of a church. There can be a church that looks great financially on paper, but they may have long ago wandered away, drifted away from their purpose and why they are here. And so for us, how do we measure success? We have to ask that question on a regular basis. What is success for Boulder Creek Community Church? At some level, it has to do with people who are giving joyfully and sacrificially. It's not about money, but if God doesn't have your wallet, he doesn't have your heart. People are giving joyfully and sacrificially. People are also growing deeper in their faith and in their trust of God. Last week or a couple weeks ago, I challenged you 15 minutes a day. Sit down, be still, be quiet, put away the technology and just sit and be with God. Read his word, pray. My new schedule, now that I'm teaching Bible at Baymont, meant I'm gonna lose sleep. I've gotta get up earlier now, 5 days a week rather than 2 days a week. And so I decided I'm going to get up an hour earlier. I cannot compromise that time that I have established, that habit that I established many, many years ago where I put God first. And here's the beauty of it. It's similar with money. I have found that when I'm willing to give 10%, that 90% goes further than 100%. And I found that when I give God that first part of my day, even if I have a really, really busy schedule, if I will pause and sit still and give God that first part of my day, I seem to have enough time to get everything done that I need to get done. I don't know how it works all the time, but it does. And so our mission is his mission. His mission, I should say, is our mission. We are looking at this to remind ourselves that God has given us a mission. A couple weeks ago, I put up this slide with these concentric circles. Where are you? And we're all at different places in terms of our relationship with God. And I simply put this up here as a way for you to kind of say, well, where am I? And what do I need to do to kind of move to that next level where I move from kind of the crowd out here on the outer circle. And think about it. Jesus had that these concentric circles as well. You had the crowds. And then as you move in, you had maybe 150 or so people that walked with Jesus and followed him and believed him. And then you had the 72 that he sent out to go and share the gospel in these other towns. And then you had the 12. And then you had three. There was three people, three disciples. I think it was Peter, Andrew, and John. And he would often separate them from the other 12 and, hey, come here. I want you to be a part of this. Two of them got to see him transfigured on the mountain. Three of them got to see him in closed doors heal a little boy, a little girl, I think it was. And then there was one. There was John. If you read through the Gospel of John, over and over, he refers to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. And I love that. What if you could look in the mirror and say that? I am Gabriel, the disciple whom Jesus loves. I am Ron, the disciple whom Jesus loves. In fact, he had such an intimate and close relationship with Jesus that at the Last Supper, because of the way they ate back then, they kind of laid on their sides, on their elbow, and they would eat off the table that was low. He laid his head on the breast of Jesus. He had this beautiful, intimate relationship with God. And here's the thing. That is available to every single one of us. That invitation is available to every single one of us. And so these concentric circles is really a way for us to say, we need to move from being consumers, what's in it for me, what do I get out of it, to what can I give? How can I serve? What does it look like for me to love God today? Who's God going to bring into my life that I can help, that I can serve? So let's read Luke chapter 4. I just want to read three or four verses here. I'm going to start in verse 16, just to remind us of what Jesus said about his mission. He went to Nazareth, where he grew up, by the way. Or it says that next, where he had been brought up. And on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. And he stood up to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor." And we talked all about that last week. "He sent me also to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, recovery of sight to the blind, and to release the oppressed, and finally to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." See, what matters most to Jesus is all right here. This is what matters most to Jesus, is the work of helping people to know that God is alive, that God is present, that God loves them, and that he is there for them. Some of you need to hear those words. God is for you. He's not against you. He is for you. Despite the mistakes and the failures and the inconsistency that you have had in your life, he is for you. And like I said last week, we talked about how the good news is only for the poor or the poor in spirit. And remember, being poor in spirit means that you recognize your inability to be good enough. We are beggars before God. We have nothing to say, "God, I deserve. I've been really good." Being poor means that we have to recognize our inability to be good enough to earn God's favor. It means that you and I need a Savior. And that's what Jesus came to do. John says that he did not come to punish or to condemn the world, but rather to save the world. And anyone who puts their hope, who puts their trust in him, has the right, it says in John chapter 1, to become children of God. And such we are. And such we are. And that's where we start. That's where we cross the line from darkness to light, from death to life. But as many of you know, and you've probably experienced, that just because we give our lives to Christ doesn't mean life gets easier. In fact, it should get harder in some respects, because you think about it. When you give your life to Christ and you begin to go after Jesus and begin to follow Jesus, you've got the entire world going against you. You have an enemy, Satan, who goes against you. So you should expect difficulty and resistance if you are really following Christ. But let's look at the final three aspects or components of the purpose of Jesus. Freedom for the prisoners. Now, the image here, as he uses this idea of prisoner, it conjures up in the original readers' minds, these are prisoners of war. They've been caught. They've been captivated. They're held as prisoners of war. But my question is, what does freedom look like? What does freedom mean? What's Jesus talking about here? Because he's talking to people who are not literally in prison. Wilma's going to be in prison tonight. Where's Wilma? She finally got caught after, no. She's going to help these prisoners be set free in the true sense of freedom. See, the good news, and this is important, we'll never fully understand the good news until we understand that there's bad news. So you and I are sinners. That's the bad news. We are first enemies of God. That's the bad news. We are under condemnation, under judgment. That's the bad news. But the big picture of the Bible, the gospel, the good news is that Jesus has not come to reform us. This is not a self-improvement plan. He hasn't come to supplement our lives. He's come to save our lives from condemnation, to save us from punishment, to save us from judgment, and to save us for something. We're not just being saved from something, but we're also being saved for something. And we're being saved for a life of meaning and a life of purpose. It's kind of like if someone had cancer. What you need when you have cancer is a cure. You don't need a self-improvement plan. You don't need information. You don't need some document to read. Or if you're in a burning building and you're stuck in a burning building, you don't need someone going, hey, you thirsty? You want a drink of water? No, you need rescued. And that is the condition that we are in before we come to Christ. We need to be rescued. And so salvation is first and foremost freedom from sin. Not economic salvation, not psychological, not emotional, not social, although those areas of our life tend to improve as we follow Christ. But unlike our legal system, sins are not weighted by their seriousness. There are no misdemeanors in the realm of sin. Sin is sin. And sin is not just the wrong stuff that we do, but it's also the good that we don't do. And God takes sin really seriously. In fact, he takes sin so seriously that he was willing to take on human flesh, come and live in this world, and eventually die on a cross. That's how serious God takes sin. When I was in college, I was studying this idea of sin, and I went on to the campus at San Jose State, which is just down the street, and I decided to do as many interviews as I could, and I would ask people two questions. Tell me what you think sin means. And the typical answer I got was, well, to do something wrong. But then I would follow it up with this question, are you a sinner? Oh man, the number of people that gave me dirty looks and that I offended, and this is back in the 80s, imagine today. But the funniest one I got was two nuns walking through campus, and I said, hey, can I ask you a couple questions? Most other people were like, no, I'm not a sinner, I'm a good person. But then I asked these nuns, who were probably the best two people there that I interviewed, I asked them what sin was, and then I followed up, are you sinners? Oh yeah, yeah. That good old Catholic guilt, huh? Have you ever heard of phantom pain? This is something that sometimes people who have had an amputation might experience. The limb is no longer there, but the pain, the brain still is sending signals, and they still feel a sensation of pain. And likewise, many people who come to Christ, even though we've been declared free of the penalty of sin, not always the consequences. Stupid should hurt. Remember that. That's my favorite quote. You reap what you sow. There's always consequences. But yet, there are many people who are in Christ who have been set free, and yet they are still imprisoned by shame, by guilt. In fact, that was me for a long time, and I've shared this before. And finally, when I took a class called Theodicy, and then I took the leadership course, and I've been teaching that class for 17 years now. In fact, we've got another one coming up. Would love for you to sign up for Theodicy. But it was really what helped me take what I knew up here, head knowledge, and it became heart knowledge. And I was free. I remember waking up one day when I lived in a house in Saratoga, and that was the month we had to move where rents in San Jose passed up rents in San Francisco, and I was unemployed. And then the county called us and said, hey, we got this little boy named Johnny, will you take him? And my life felt like it was crumbling and falling apart, not because of you, Johnny. But I'm the provider, and I was failing, and so I was really struggling. And then one day while we were living in that house in Saratoga, I woke up, and I'll never forget, I felt loved. I hadn't prayed yet, hadn't read my Bible, hadn't done anything to perform. I just felt loved. I was free. I was free not only from the consequences of sin, but I was free from condemnation. I was free from the shame. I was free from the guilt. And so there is a freedom that many of us have not yet stepped into. Think about it. The freedom to forgive others. The freedom to forgive yourself for the things that you've done. The freedom to try something new and yet fail. The freedom to be who you really are. Freedom from a fear that cripples you and keeps you from doing what God wants you to do. A freedom from the need of approval of certain other people. Freedom from shame, freedom from guilt, freedom from insecurities, freedom from a poor self-image, freedom from condemnation, freedom from false assumptions about who you are and who you are for God. Not only are we free from these things, but we are also set free for something, as I said, for mission, for purpose, for calling. We are set free to be something and to be someone that matters to God and who can accomplish great things for God. I used to love to go and visit prisons, as Wilma's going to do tonight, but I would take a round rubber ball and I would go into prisons and play basketball, and I'll never forget one prisoner I met. He was the first prisoner I ever talked to who said he was guilty. His name was Michael, and he told me a story. You're not supposed to ask them why they're in prison, but we developed this relationship. We wrote back and forth, and one time I just kind of broke the rules and I said, "So, Michael, why are you here, man?" He goes, "Well, I walked in on a guy who was molesting my little brother, and I killed him. And you know what I thought? If I was in his shoes, if I'd been born where he was born and walked in his shoes, I would probably be in prison too. But I'll tell you what, Michael found Christ in prison, and he had a freedom that millionaires over in Silicon Valley don't have. Because he was free from the consequences, the condemnation of his sin." Galatians 5:1 says, "It is for freedom that Christ has set us free." And then he says, "Stand firm." In other words, hold the line. Don't give in. Don't give up. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Next, Jesus says, "I've come to give recovery of sight for the blind." We're given sight. Think about that. What does it mean to be blind? To be sure, Jesus would heal people physically born blind, but there is a blindness. In fact, he sometimes would heal someone blind in order to make a message clear to the Pharisees, who had all the knowledge but were truly blind. There is a spiritual blindness, a blindness to the truth. Think about this. The Pharisees, other religious folks, Pilate, the Roman soldiers, Judas, they all saw Jesus, but they didn't see. They saw, but they didn't see. Some of you remember when you first saw the truth of who God is and who he is for you. And in spite of all the hypocrites in the church, despite bad church experiences, despite disbelief, your eyes were opened and you saw. And for some of us, we grew up in church our whole lives and we never truly saw. And then one day, God opened up our eyes and we saw. And I love the song when we sing it, "I was blind, but now I see." One of the reasons we must be patient and yet persistent with people who do not yet see is because they are spiritually blind. That's why we cannot argue someone into the kingdom of God, because we can give all the right answers, and there is a time to answer questions, but we can give all the right answers, but there is a blindness that will not allow them to see. And so as we pray, one of our prayers for our friends and our family is that God would open up their eyes and help them to see. But yet, even as Christians, what is it that we might be blind to today? Maybe some of us are blind to God's abiding love in our lives. You hear the words, "God loves me," but you don't really feel it. Some of us are blind to his holiness and his righteousness. Some of us might be blind to what really matters in life, or blind to what real wealth looks like, or blind to how valuable you are to God. Or maybe some of us are blind to our own selfishness. Blind to our own greed. Have you noticed, though, how easy it is to point out other people's faults? Come on. We're all guilty of that in some way or another. Some of you might remember the early days of American Idol. You remember that show? Anybody watch that? The old days, American Idol? And they inevitably have someone who thought they were the bomb, that they were a future star, and they get up on the stage and they would completely just, oh, it was terrible. And then when they were rejected, they were so surprised. Their mommy told them their whole lives, you're the greatest, you're the greatest, you're the greatest. Never told them the truth, and they were so distraught and so upset that they were never gonna be a superstar. It was entertaining and embarrassing in some levels as their hopes and aspirations were crushed. Why do I take pleasure in that? That says something wrong about me. But imagine if our 10 worst moments were flashed on the big screen for the whole world to see. No thank you is right. No thank you is right. But sometimes we are the last ones to see our blind spots. We need loving people, caring people, people who will speak the truth in love. And often that's our spouse. I probably told this story before. I'll tell it again, I'm sure. But I was reminded of Linda, who I met in Swaziland. She was half Mozambican, half European. And she wanted to meet with me with one day. And she was this stunningly beautiful 17-year-old girl with, you know, brown skin and stunning green eyes. And she came to me, and she was so distraught and so upset. She says, Adam, I hate myself, and I don't know why I'm here. She said, not only do I not know why I'm here, I shouldn't be here, I shouldn't exist. And I'm like, whoa, Linda, tell me your story. It turns out her father from Europe had been on contract in Mozambique and hooked up with a girl, got her pregnant, and about 3 months later, she showed up at his door. I'm pregnant. Oh. Well, here's some money, go get an abortion. On the way to the abortion clinic, she saw a bar, ended up going there. She's distraught, she's unhappy, she's grieving, and she ended up drinking all the money away. And so about 9-10 months later, she went back to his door. This is your baby girl. Handed her to him and left. And I want to punch his lights out for telling her this whole story. Why would you tell your daughter that, especially at such a vulnerable age? And so I told her, because she was blind. She was blind to her beauty, to her worth, to her value. She was blind that God, maybe her parents didn't want her, but God did. God wanted you. He knit you together in your mother's womb, I told her. And God has purpose and God has a plan. And God wants to use your life. I never saw her again. School was ending and she went back to Mozambique. Never saw her again. I don't know if she was able to receive the words I had. But I use that as an example that sometimes we carry with us this inability to see who God is for us. The inability to see our value and our worth that is given to us by God. And finally, Jesus has come to release the oppressed. To release the oppressed. And what does it mean to be oppressed? It means that we're overburdened. Means that we're troubled, that we're worried, that we're weighed down by life, by our past, by our problems, by our circumstances. And I want to remind you of one of the greatest passages in Scripture, from my opinion, Matthew chapter 11, 28 and 29. Jesus says, come to me. Don't come to a religion. Don't come to the law. Don't come to a set of rules and do's and don'ts. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. See, the burden here that Jesus is referring to is about having to be perfect, having to perform, having to do enough, be good enough for God to love you. And if we could just grasp, if we could just wrap our heads and our hearts around this truth, God loves you as you are, not as you ought to be. He also loves you too much to let you stay the way you are. New life demands new growth. But it starts with accepting the reality we are loved as we are. Remember what we said earlier that God takes sin seriously. Not only does sin offend a holy and righteous God, but God also takes sin seriously because of what it does to our own souls. Imagine what an unburdened soul, an unoppressed soul would look like. I thought about this and I just wrote down a few things, and maybe one of these things will speak to your heart. Imagine being able to say yes with or no without anxiety or duplicity. Imagine being able to speak with confidence and honesty. Imagine being willing, and for some of you, this might hit home, imagine being willing to disappoint somebody or anybody and still be okay. Imagine being ready to bless anybody. Imagine having a mind filled with noble thoughts. Imagine being able to share without double thinking or questioning. Imagine living without the feeling of constantly being judged. Imagine being so genuinely humble that each person you encounter, you would see them as an object of wonder, as someone who's made in the image of God. Imagine being able to love God with your whole heart, mind, soul, and strength, irregardless of where it takes you, no matter what other people might think or say. And so in conclusion, there is a quality of life that we all long for. But listen, it is completely disconnected from your health, from your wealth, or your reputation. There is a quality of life that we all long for, but in Christ, it is completely disconnected from your health, from your wealth, or your reputation. And the freedom I speak of is not a freedom that can be taken away. It cannot be locked up. The peace that Jesus offers is a peace that is not limited by your circumstances. And it may be that your circumstances, it may be for some of you, that your circumstances are God's way of helping you to see what you need to see. Because the issue is not out here, it's in here. Jesus said it this way, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal." The life, the purpose, the peace, the love that Jesus offers cannot be stolen. And this is the ministry of Jesus, and guess what? It is also the ministry that you and I are being invited to. And think if we could just step into this freedom, if we could just see that God wants us, see what he wants us to see, if we could just let go of the burdens that we're not meant to carry, how different would our lives look? And so I want to close today's service a little bit different before we take communion. I would like you all to stand. And I would like you to put out your hands like this. And this is a posture of not only receiving, but it's also a posture of letting go. What are the things that you need to let go of? What are the things that God wants you to hold on to? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we hold up our hands to you, and our hands are open because our hearts are open to receive what you have for us. Our hands are open because we are letting go of the things that hold us back and drag us down and keep us from the abundant life that you offer us. And so God, with our hands lifted up and our hearts lifted up, we say, come, give us what you want to give us. We want to have the faith. God, strengthen our faith, grow our faith. Give us the faith that we need to receive the things that you have for us and to walk in them faithfully. Help us to be the people and help us to be the church that you dream of us becoming. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen.